الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد إن شاء الله تعالى today we're going to start the كتاب القصيدة الهائية في الزهد والترغيب والترهيب written by the great scholar الإمام Hafidh ibn Ahmad ibn Ali Al-Hakami rahimahullah. The Sheikh is well known for his works, especially writing books in poetic forms. He has many manzumat that he's written. One of the most famous ones is his kitab Sulamul Wusul ila Ilm al-Usul, which he then explained in a three-volume book known as Ma'arij al-Qubul. So this kitab is one of his works that he's written, Al-Imam Al-Hakami rahimahullah. And so inshallah ta'ala, we're going to start today and take portions of it bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. As you can see from the name, the kitab, it talks about az-zuhd, to be aesthetic, and it also talks about the things that you should and shouldn't do, the things that the Sharia encourage you to do and the things that the Sharia warns you against. So this kitab inshallah ta'ala, it falls under heart softening. It's not a technical book. It is good for every single person who inshallah ta'ala feels qaswatul qalb, the darkness of the heart. And brothers and sisters, what we really need to work on is to purify and cleanse our hearts. Especially at a time like this, it's one of the things that we should work hard on. Ibn Sa'd rahimahullah, he mentions in his tabaqat that Maymun ibn Mihran, and Maymun ibn Mihran, he was a katib li Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. Maymun ibn Mihran. And the Imam al-Dhahabi in his seer, he mentions, وَكَانَ عُمَرُ بْنُ عَبْدِ الْعَزِيزِ لَا يُقَرِّبُ إِلَّا الْأَفَاضِلِ. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, because he was a righteous man, a noble man, the people that he used to make sure that were around him were righteous people. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. And Maymun ibn Mihran was a writer for him. Was the katib of Umar ibn Aziz. So he used to be close to Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. Maymun ibn Mihran, one day he felt qaswatul qalb, he felt darkness on his heart. And at this time, he lost his eyesight. So Maymun ibn Mihran said to his son, take me to Hassan al-Basri. Take me to Hassan al-Basri. I want to go to him and I want him to give me some words. Hassan al-Basri, who is he? وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ عَنْ حَسَنَ الْبَصْرِي Hassan al-Basri is a great imam. Dhabi rahimahullah mentions, Hassan al-Basri was like رَجُلٌ ذَهَبَ بِالْآخِرَةِ مَذَابَ إِلَى الْآخِرَةِ A man who went to the Akhirah. فَعَيَنَهَا And he saw everything in the Akhirah. فَجَاءَ لِيُخْبِرَ النَّاسَ بِهِ And he came back to this earth to tell the people about what he saw. That's how eloquent his speech were. The words that he said penetrated the people's hearts. It was like he was talking for something he saw. For example, one of his very eloquent statements was, وَإِنْ طَقْطَقَتْ بِهِمُ الْبِغَالِ وَأَمْلَجَتْ بِهِمُ الْبَرَاذِينَ فَإِنَّ ذُلَّ الْمَعْصِيَةِ لَا تُفَارِقُ وُجُوهَهُمْ أَبَى اللَّهُ إِلَّا أَنْ يُذِلَّ مَنْ عَصَاهُ So Hassan was known for his eloquency. And he used to touch people's hearts. So Maymun ibn Mihran knew that he should go to Hassan al-Basri, and that's the person that would help him the most. So his son grabbed him. Maymun ibn Mihran's son grabbed him by the hand and he took him to the direction of the house of Hassan al-Basri. They reached the house of Hassan al-Basri and they knocked on the door. The servant of Hassan al-Basri said, Man, who's at the door? And then he said, Maymun ibn Mihran and my son. She said to him, Ya Shaykh al-Su, ma abqaka fi hadha al-zaman al-Su. She said, Oh, you evil Shaykh, why are you alive at this evil time? This hurt the heart of Maymun ibn Mihran and he started to cry. As he was crying, Hassan al-Basri came out. He said to him, enter the house. He entered onto Hassan al-Basri. Maymun came in, sat down, and he said to him, Ya Aba Sa'id, that was the kunya of Hassan al-Basri. Inni ajidu fi qalbi qaswa. Maymun said, I find in my heart darkness. My heart is not as it used to be. فَقُلْ لِي Say to me, شَيْءٌ أَتَّشَبَّثُ بِهِ Something I can hold on to. Say some words to me that can help me, that can benefit me. Hassan al-Basri said, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم أفرأيت إن متعناهم سنين ثم جاءهم ما كانوا يوعدون ما أغنى عنهم ما كانوا يمتعون. Hassan al-Basri said, recited only those three verses. And Maymun ibn Mihran cried and wept. Allah says in these three verses, أَفَرَأَيْتَ Do you not see Muhammad? أَفَرَأَيْتَ إِمَّا تَعْنَاهُمْ سِنِينَ If we give them, these people on this earth, a short period of time where they can enjoy themselves. أَفَرَأَيْتَ إِمَّا تَعْنَاهُمْ سِنِينَ ثم after that, ثُمَّ جَاءَهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يُعَدُونَ It comes to them that which was promised to them. مَا أَغْنَى عَنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يُمَتَّعُونَ Whatever they were enjoying themselves with would not benefit them that day. Those words penetrated the heart of Maymun ibn Mihran and he fainted. When he regained consciousness, Hassan al-Basri said, you can now leave inshaAllah ta'ala. As they were leaving, Maymun ibn Mihran's son looked at his father Maymun and he said, Dad, was that Hassan al-Basri? Maymun said, yeah, that was Hassan al-Basri. He said, but why didn't he say anything? He just recited three verses on you. And then Maymun said to him, Wallahi, he recited verses that if it was recited to a person whose heart was awake, it would make them feel it. I mean, whose words is greater than the words of Allah? Now, brothers and sisters, let's take something from this story. How many of us hearts are dying? We're feeling qaswatul qalb. But we don't go to people who can help us. If we have a toothache, we go to the dentist. If we have a headache or some illness, we go to the doctor. But when it comes to the darkness of our hearts and the qaswatul qalb, do we go to the people of knowledge, people of understanding of the religion, and say, irdhni, give me a reminder, something's going to benefit me. Do we say that? How many of us are walking around and our hearts are dead? And that's what really matters, brothers and sisters. It's the heart that matters. Hadith Sahih Muslim, min Hadith Abi Hurairah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ أَجْسَامِكُمْ وَلَا إِلَىٰ صُوَرِكُمْ وَلَكِ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ عَمَالِكُمْ Allah does not look at your physique. The thing that we care the most about, and we're so concerned about. Allah doesn't look at it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. What Allah tabarak wa ta'ala looks at is the person's heart and their action. It's what Allah looks at, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Taqwa, which is what will save you from the hellfire, as Allah mentioned in the Quran. وَإِن مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا وَارِدُهَا أَيْ فِي جَهَنَّمْ كَانَ عَلَىٰ رَبِّكَ حَتْمًا مَقَضِيًّا ثُمَّ نُنَجِّ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا وَنَظَرُ الظَّالِمِينَ فِيهَا جِثِيًّا The people Allah said is going to save are who? أهل التقوى, the people of piety. Also Allah said in another ayah, وَتِلْكَ الْجَنَّةُ الَّتِي نُورِثُ مِنْ عِبَادِنَا مَنْ كَانَ تَقِيًّا Jannah is inherited, it's given to the people of taqwa. Where does taqwa come from? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "At-taqwa ha huna," fa ashara ila sadrihi thalath marrat. The Prophet said, "Taqwa comes from the heart. It's the heart." So the heart, brothers and sisters, is very important. When you're seeking knowledge, and you're learning masail ilmiyah, sometimes you need to go towards heart-softening books and read them. So now, inshallah ta'ala, this book is going to be one of those books. Inshallah ta'ala, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bi mannihi wa karami. That Allah benefits us with it, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and makes it a hujjah for us and not a hujjah against us. إِنَّهُ وَلِيُّ ذَلِكَ وَالْقَادِرُ عَلَيْهِ نعم.
وَمَا لِي وَلِي الدُّنْيَا وَلَيْسَتْ بِبُغْيَتِي وَلَا مُنْتَهَى قَصْدِي وَلَسْتُ أَنَا لَهَا وَلَسْتُ بِمَيَّالٍ إِلَيْهَا وَلَا إِلَى رِئَاسَتِهَا نَتْنًا وَقُبْحًا لِحَالِهَا
The author, rahimahullah, he started his qasida and his nazm by saying, مالي وللدنيا وليست ببغيتي. The word بغيتي, it means مطلبي ومقصدي. The dunya is not my objective. It's not my ultimate goal. It's a stepping stone. Look at the difference of the Sheikh's kalam and our reality. Compare the two. He doesn't see this world as his ultimate goal. When your mind sets like that, you don't get hurt by this dunya and what it offers you and what happens within this dunya. Because it doesn't mean anything to you. It's a stepping stone to something greater and bigger for you. This statement of his, مَالِي وَلِدُّنْيَا, he took it from a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. And Imam Ahmad narrated it in Musnadihi, and Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah authenticated in his kitab, Sisila Hadith al-Sahiha. That the Prophet said, مَالِي وَلِدُّنْيَا إِلَّا كَرَاكِبٍ إِسْتَظَلَّ تَحْتَ شَجَرَةٍ فَرَاحَ وَتَرَكَهَا. كَمَا قَالَ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. The Prophet said, what is this dunya to me? So the Shaykh is following who? The Shaykh is following the Prophet's statement. This in Arabic is called iqtibas. Iqtibas means you take the statement of the Prophet and you merge it into your own speech. The Shaykh is following the Prophet ﷺ. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. The Prophet said, what is this dunya to me? Nothing. It means nothing to me. I am like in this dunya, كَرَاكِبٍ, a rider. اسْتَظَلَّ تَحْتَ شَجَرَةٍ, who went under a tree to find shade. ثُمَّ رَاحَ وَتَرَكَهَا, and then I left it. That's what the dunya is to me, the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was one who used to teach his companions, the Prophet, not just verbally, but sometimes he would show them, as they say in English, a picture draws more than 1,000 words. Sometimes drawing something for people allows them to picture it even more, right? And the Prophet used to use that method, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sometimes. The Prophet one day wanted to really drive the point home that this dunya doesn't mean anything. So what did he do? He picked up a dead corpse, grabbed it by the ear. And the Prophet said, who's going to buy this from me? They said, Ya Rasulullah, no one. No one's going to buy this from you. If this animal was alive, hatta no one would buy it from you. Because it was a crippled يعني, animal. It didn't have all of its limbs. If this animal was alive, no one would buy it from you. Now that it's dead, no one definitely would take it from you. The Prophet ﷺ said, الدنيا أهون. The dunya is lower to Allah tabaraka ta'ala min hadha, this for the one who owned it. I'm the people right now, to you guys. And the fact that the dunya doesn't mean anything to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the reason why Allah allowed the non-Muslims to have it. لو كانت الدنيا تعدل عند الله جناح بعوضة ما سقى منها كافر شربة ماء. The fact that the disbeliever can drink water from this dunya and enjoy himself in this dunya is actually because it means nothing to Allah. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَوْلَا أَن يَكُونَ النَّاسُ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً لَجَعَلْنَا لِمَنْ يَكْفُرُ بِالرَّحْمَنِ لِبُيُوتِهِمْ سُقُفًا مِنْ فِضَّةٍ وَمَعَارِجَ عَلَيْهَا يَظْهَرُونَ وَلِبُيُوتِهِمْ أَبْوَابٌ وَسُرُرًا عَلَيْهَا يَتَّكِئُونَ وَزُخْرُفًا وَإِنْ كُلُّ ذَلِكَ لَمَّا مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةُ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. Akhirah is what is noble and great. The disbeliever is not given that. Akhirah is for the muttaqeen. Like in the dunya, the non-Muslim and the Muslim might have it the same. And that's why the scholars like Ibn al-Qayyim and Ibn al-Aqil and others, they mention i'ta al-dunyawi, getting this dunya given to you, لا يدن على محبة الله تبارك وتعالى. Doesn't mean Allah loves you by giving you this dunya. Because Allah gives it to the Muslim and the non-Muslim. Because it means nothing to Allah تبارك وتعالى. The dunya means nothing. So the creator who created this dunya is saying that it means nothing. Why should it mean something to you? It should mean nothing to you. So that's what the author here is saying. مَا لِلدُّنْيَا. What is the relationship between me and the dunya? وَلَيْسَتْ بِبُغْيَتِي. The dunya is not my ultimate goal. It's not my aspiration. And this again goes to the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, وَلَا تَجْعَلِ الدُّنْيَا أَكْبَرَهَا مِنَا. Oh Allah, do not make the dunya our ultimate goal. Oh Allah, don't make us ones who live for the dunya. Make us people who live for the akhirah. That's what the Prophet ﷺ. But brothers and sisters, that doesn't mean that you leave your children behind when you die, hungry, not needing, starving. No, take from the dunya enough to survive. Because the Prophet said to Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas when he was on his deathbed, and Sa'd thought he was going to die, but he didn't die, he actually lived from that. The Prophet said, إِنَّكَ إِن تَذَرَ وَرَثَتَكَ أَغْنِيَا خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنْ أَن تَتْرُكَهُمْ عَالَةً يَتَكَفَّفُونَ النَّاسُ وَكَمَا قَالَ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. For you to leave your family behind, rich and sufficient, not begging anyone, is better than to leave them behind with nothing to hold on to. So in Islam, of course, you're not allowed to beg and take things from other people, but it shouldn't be your ultimate goal. That's the problem. That's why the Prophet said, "Inna dunya mal'una, mal'unu ma fiha illa dhikrullahi wa ma wala." The dunya is cursed, everything in it is also cursed, the Prophet said. The word al-la'n, according to the Aimatul Lugha, like Al-Jawhari and Ibn Faris and Al-Fayruzabadi and others, they mention the word Al-La'an means Atardu bin Rahmatillah. The blessing of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala and the mercy of Allah is distanced from you. The distance from you. So that's what dunya is. ولذلك, there's a nice powerful statement of Ibn Al-Qayyim in his kitab, عُدَّةُ الصَّابِرِينَ وَذَخِيرَةُ الشَّاكِرِينَ. I mean, you can say عِدَّةُ الصَّابِرِينَ وَذَخِيرَةُ الشَّاكِرِينَ. You can say both ways. That Ibn al-Qayyim says, for dunya, لا تذم في ذاتها, something like that. He says dunya is not rebuked in and within itself, ولكن تذم لفعل صاحبها, but it's rebuked the action the person does in the dunya. The dunya is just a mazra, it's a place where you plant, okay. It does fool you, it does bring glamours and glitter. So here's a nice statement of his, inshallah ta'ala, go there and read it, bin Allahi al-Kareem. Now.
هي الدار دار الهم والغم والعنا سريع تقضيها قريب زوالها مياسيرها عسر وحزن سرورها وأرباحها خسر ونقص كمالها إذا أضحكت أبكت وإن رام وصلها غبي فيا سرع انقطاع وصالها
فيا سرع صح؟ is it فيا سرع؟ what is فيا سرعة sorry
سرعة
is it فيا سرعة؟
سرعة
yeah؟ كسر on the scene
yes سرعة
correct it to سرعة
okay
The author, rahimahullah, here he says, he talks about the reality of this dunya and the reality of the people of this dunya. This dunya, brothers and sisters, is darul hammi wal ghammi wal hana. This dunya, it's sadness, depression, headache. That's what it is. The waqi' of it is that's what it is. If you realize that's what the dunya is, if it does that to you, is it going to annoy you? No. You was expecting that from the dunya. But when you expect the dunya to bring you happiness and it doesn't bring you happiness, it brings you sadness, what are you going to feel? You're going to feel hurt. And this is the underlining point. Why so many people are depressed and on anxiety pills and etc. is they did not accept the reality of the dunya. They didn't know what the reality of the dunya is. They were given a false perception of the dunya. The dunya is darul hammi wal ghammi wal ana. Ibn al-Qayyim says something very good, powerful. He says, the reason why this dunya is darul hammi wal ghammi wal ana is because there has to be a difference between this dunya and the akhirah. There has to be a difference between akhirah and this place. If this place brings you all the happiness, then what about the akhirah? What are you expecting? Lakin, brothers and sisters, this sadness and this depression can be covered with something that can bring you joy. Yani the stress can turn into good if you do something. And that is if you come with iman and righteous actions. Allah says in the Quran, فَإِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُم مِّنِّي هُدًى فَمَنْ تَبِعَ هُدَايَ فَلَا يَضِلُّ وَلَا يَشْقَى وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكًا وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى قَالَ رَبِّ لِمَ حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا قَالَ كَذَلِكَ أَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا فَنَسِيتَهَا وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى. Allah تبارك وتعالى, he says here, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي, anyone who turns away from the remembrance of Allah, what will happen to them? وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكًا. You're going to have a hard life in this world. Some of the Mufassirin, they said this is referring to the qabr, and some scholars, they said it refers to the dunya. مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكًا, it means you're going to live a tough life. No, you're not going to enjoy yourself if you turn away from the remembrance of Allah. Allah also said in another ayah, مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٍ فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. The dunya, if you want to be happy, you have to come with iman and amal salih. ولذلك شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمة said something. He said, إِنَّ فِي الدُّنْيَا جَنَّةً مَنْ لَمْ يَدْخُلْهَا لَمْ يَدْخُلْ جَنَّةَ الْآخِرَةِ. There's an actual jannah in this world. If you don't enter the jannah of this world, you're not going to enter the jannah of the hereafter. There's two jannahs, he said. A jannah in this world and a jannah in the hereafter. What does jannah bring? Happiness, right? The jannah of this dunya, he said, it's al-iman billahi wal amal salih. Believing in Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and come with righteous actions, it's a jannah in this world. You're going to be like a boat in the middle of the sea where water's coming from all directions, because the dunya is a chaos, right? But that water doesn't go into the boat. And the boat still sails in the storm. What is happening around you in this world will never get to you, will never go inside you. Because if it does go inside you, what's going to happen? You're going to sink. Just like the boat, it will sink. So, all of that which is happening, you're still happy. You're going to enjoy yourself. That's what the author, rahimahullah, here is talking about. سَرِيعٌ تَقَضِّيهَا قَرِيبٌ زَوَالُهَا. This dunya, it goes fast. It's fast. It's not going to stay forever. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He refers to it in the Quran, اِقْتَرَبَ لِلنَّاسِ حِسَابُهُمْ اِقْتَرَبَ لِلنَّاسِ حِسَابُهُمْ وَهُمْ فِي غَفْلَةٍ مُعْرِضُونَ اِقْتَرَبَتِ السَّاعَةِ وَانْشَقَّ الْقَمَرِ إِنَّهُمْ يَرَوْنَهُ بَعِيدًا وَنَرَاهُ قَرِيبًا. All those verses are telling you, it's close. أَزِفَةِ الْآزِفَةِ لَيْسَ لَهَا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ كَاشِفَةً. Akhirah and death is very close. هُوَ أَقْرَبُ إِلَىٰ إِحْدَاكُم مِن شِرَاكٍ عَلِهِ. It's closer to you than your shoelaces. ولذلك the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم he said بعثت أنا والساعة كهاتين فأشار بالصبابة والوسطى. The Prophet said me and the Akhirah are like this, and he took two fingers and he did this عليه الصلاة والسلام. And brothers and sisters, we don't know where we're going to die. وما تدري نفس ماذا تكسب غدا وما تدري نفس بأي أرض تموت. We don't know what we're going to get tomorrow, and we don't know where we're going to die. Allah knows it subhanahu wa ta'ala. يسألك الناس عن الساعة قل إنما علمها عند ربي. All of that is with, it's all with, قُلْ إِنَّمَا عِلْمُهَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. All of its knowledge is with who? وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّ السَّاعَةَ تَكُونُ قَرِيبًا. The hour is very close, brothers. And everybody's hour is when they die and they pass away. So that's what the author, rahimahullah, is pointing out here, rahimahullah. Muhammad ibn Sirin, he said, مَا كَانَ ضحكٌ قط. There was no laughing that happened. إلا كان من بعده بكاء. Except there was a crying after it. In this dunya, the one who laughed now, but wait for him, is a crying that comes after it. That's what the dunya is. It's joy, sadness. Joy, sadness. And that's what the Shaykh rahimahullah here means. That if it makes you laugh for a short period of time, it saddens you for a long, long time. Naam.
فأسأل ربي أن يحول بحوله وقوته بيني وبين اغتيالها.
So the Shaykh rahimahullah, he said, I ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And this is basically what Bukhari did in his kitab, in his sahih, right? When he chapter Babu At-Ta'awudhu Billahi Min Fitnati Dunya, sah? It's the same thing he's doing. Seeking refuge in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala from the fitna of this dunya. The dunya has fitna, brothers and sisters. It's full of fitness. So the Shaykh rahimahullah, he's asking Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, Allahumma aslih li deeni alladhi huwa ismatu amri wa aslih li dunyaya allati fiha ma'ashi wa aslih li akhirati allati fiha ma'adi waj'al al-hayata ziyadatan li fi kulli khair waj'al al-mauta rahatan li min kulli shar. That's what he's saying. I ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala that the dunya doesn't become the thing that assassinates me and destroys me. And that's what the dunya does to the person. If they don't seek refuge in Allah from it subhanahu wa ta'ala, the dunya will destroy you. How many people has Allah given them the dunya subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they became someone different than they were before? Some people, they will say to you, I didn't even know myself. I got to know myself when the dunya was open for me. A lot of people say to them, oh, you've changed. You're not like who you used to be. So the dunya, what it does to people is, it destroys them. And that's what the Shaykh rahimahullah is seeking refuge in Allah from it subhanahu wa ta'ala. What we want to be in this dunya is مفاتيح للخير مغاليق للشر. We want to be the keys to good and the locks to evil. May Allah make us subhanahu wa ta'ala. نعم.
فيا طالب الدنيا الدنية جاهدا ألطلب سواها إنها لا وفى لها فكم قد رأينا من حريص ومشفق عليها فلم يظفر بها أن ينالها.
That's what it is. كَلَّا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَطْغَى أَرْرَاهُ اسْتَغْنَى. Everyone running after this dunya. يعني look what the Shaykh says. إِنَّهَا لَا وَفَاءَ لَهَا. It has يعني مَتَاعٌ غُرُورٌ. It's a غُرُور. It's deception. It's deceiving you. What it promises you, it doesn't give you. So don't look for it. Don't seek it too much. It's a stepping stone. Brothers and sisters, the man who eats $1,000 food and the one he eats a dry bread and water, they both ate food and they're both full. And both people have eaten. This one spent $1,000 on eating. This one spent what? A dry bread and water. He drank two together, he's full. So, yani, don't stress too much about the dunya. live in this dunya to survive, benefit from it. كُنْ فِي الدُّنْيَا كَأَنَّكَ غَرِيبٌ أَوْ عَابِرِ السَّبِيلِ. Be a person like crossing a road or a stranger. Abdullah ibn Umar, what did he say after that? He said from that day onwards, when the Prophet said that to him, he advised him that, he said that he took this from the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, and he did what? إِذَا أَمْسَيْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظِرِ الصَّبَاحِ وَإِذَا أَصْبَحْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظِرِ الْمَسَاءِ وَخُذْ مِنْ صِحَتِكَ لِمَرَضِكَ وَمِنْ حَيَاتِكَ لِمَوْتِكَ. He used to just take from the dunya that which benefits him. He benefited from his health by doing righteous actions before illness comes. He benefited from his life in this world before death came to him. The wise, the smart person is the person who benefits from his existence in this world, doesn't get caught up with it. This country that we're in right now, this, the dunya is open. And a lot of people get distracted by it. But you're not going to take from this dunya except a white cloth. And everything else is going to be taken as inheritance. You're going to lose everything, even your name. They won't refer to you by your name when you're when your body's being washed before you be taken to your grave. They're not going to refer to you by your name. They're going to say, pick up the dead body. That's your name now, the dead body. You've lost everything you owned. Your name has gone. Your clothes has been taken from you. Your money and everything is going to be inherited. Khalas. قُضِيَ الْأَمْرِ. The one thing you're going to wish for, my brothers and sisters, is righteous actions. حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدُهُمُ الْمَوْتُ قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونِ لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِي مَا تَرَكْتْ. كَلَّا إِنَّهَا كَلِمَةٌ هُوَ قَائِلُهَا وَمِن وَرَائِهِم بَرْزُخٌ إِلَى يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ. The person will wish if he can be taken back to the dunya so he can do righteous actions. So he can do righteous deeds. That's what he wishes for. That's what he wants to do. كَلَّا إِنَّهَا كَلِمَةٌ هُوَ قَائِلُهَا. It's fascinating. Allah referred to it as kalima. When the person actually said a whole entire sentence, jumla, kalima is actually referred to just as one word. But here, what did jumla? قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونِ لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِي مَا تَرَكْتْ. Allah referred to all of that as kalima. Like it's nothing what you said. So of no weight. The poet, he said, يُمَثِّلُ ذِي اللُّبِّ فِي لُبِّ مَصَائِبَ قَبْلَ أَن تَنْزِلَ فَإِنْ نَزَلَتْ بَغْتَةً لَمْ تَرُعُهُ لِمَا كَانَ فِي نَفْسِهِ مَثَلَا وَذُو الْجَهْلِ يَا مَنْ أَيَّامَهُ وَيَنْسَى مَصَارِعَ مَنْ قَدَ خَلَى فَإِنْ دَهِمَتْهُ صُرُوفُ الزَّمَانِ بِبَعْضِ مَسَائِبِهِ أَعُلَى. They used to, the early people, they used to take themselves and they used to get a grave in their own house. They would make a grave hole inside their own house and they would place themselves inside it and they would lie down. And then they will say, قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونِي لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِي مَا تَرَكْتَ. And they will come out and they will say, Allah has given me a second chance. And they work hard. And they work hard. So brothers and sisters, do not give everything to this dunya. This dunya, it lies, it deceives you. It's a mirage. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَعْمَالُمْ كَسَرَابٍ بِقِيَحٍ يَحْسَبُهُ الظَّمْآنُ مَاءً. It's like the mirage. You're driving on the road, you see water. That's how the dunya is deceiving you. The poet, he said, he said, you can remove. He said, يُطْرَدُ الْجُوعُ بِالرَّغِيفِ الْيَابِسِ فَعَلَى مَا يَكْثُرُ حَسْرَتِي وَوَسَاوِسِي. يُطْرَدُ الْجُوعُ بِالرَّغِيفِ الْيَابِسِ. Hunger can be removed with a dry bread. فَعَلَى مَا تَكْثُرْ حَسْرَتِي وَوَسَاوِسِي. Why am I, my whispers and my, يعني my sadness, why is it so much? Why am I so sad? If I can get rid of hunger by just dry bread and water, how many of us can find that? Imagine I was to say this to you, which is something that happened. That one day, Nabiullah Muhammad, Sayyid Waladi Adam, came out of his house one day in ajl al-ju', because of hunger, couldn't find something to eat. And then he saw Wazirah Abu Bakr al-Umar walking and he said, مَا الَّذِي أَخْرَجَكُمَا. Why are you both out and about? They said, Umar, Abu Bakr said, al-ju'u ya Rasulullah. I came out because I'm hungry. The Prophet then sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَالَّذِي بَعَثَنِي بِالْحَقِّ مَا أَخْرَجَنِي إِلَّا الَّذِي أَخْرَجَكُمَا. I swear by the Lord that has sent me out, there's nothing else that brought me out of my house except what has brought both of you out. I'm hungry. This is what the dunya is. It meant nothing to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He could have got the world and everything. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, they said he was a righteous man. His qissa is ajeeba. One day, a woman came into the house of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz's wife, Fatima binti Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. She was the daughter of Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, Fatima. She was married to Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. Umar ibn Aziz is one of the leaders of Bani Umayyah, right? So Fatima was one day sitting. A woman entered onto her and she saw a man fixing the house and painting the house and sorting it out. So the woman said to Fatima, "Ittaqillah, why are you not wearing your hijab in front of this man?" And Fatima cried and she said, "Wallahi, that's my husband, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, the leader of the Muslims. He's fixing his house and sorting out." They said about Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, he died reciting the ayah, "Tilka ad-daru al-akhirah, naj'aluha lil-ladina la yuriduna 'uluwwan fil ardi wa la fasada wal 'aqibatu lil-muttaqin." He was reciting that ayah when he died. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'ah. That the akhirah is for the people who are righteous. It's for the people who don't want to be high in this world. They're not looking for anything. Naam.
لقد جاء في آي الحديد ويونس وفي الكهف إيضاح بضرب مثالها وفي آل عمران وسورة فاطر وفي غافر قد جاءت بيان حالها وفي سورة الأحقاف أعظم واعظ وكم من حديث موجب لاعتزالها.
The Sheikh رحمه الله says in these three lines he mentions the reality of this dunya and how it is. It's been mentioned in a few surahs. From them is Surah Al-Hadid, where Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala says, "I'lamu annama al-hayatu dunya lahu wa la'ib." Know the reality of this dunya, that it's what? "I'lamu annama al-hayatu dunya la'ib wa lahu wa zinatu wa tafakhurun baynakum wa takathuru fil amwali wal awladi kamathali ghaythin a'jaba al-kuffara nabatuhu thumma yahiju fatarahu musfarra thumma yaj'aluhu hutama wa fil akhirati adabun shadidun وَمَغْفِرَةٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرِضْوَانٌ وَمَنْ حَيَةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاعُ الْغُرُورِ. That ayah Allah تبارك وتعالى started it by saying اِعْلَمُوا know. It's kalimatu tu'ta لِلْتَنْبِيهِ. It's used to bring your اِعْلَمُوا know. Keep this in your mind. Know it. It's kalimatu تَنْبِيهِ. Know. You use this word اِعْلَمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيْ كَلَامٍ عَظِيمٍ if you want to say something very big. اِعْلَمُوا know. What should we know? That this dunya is la'ibun wa lahun. This dunya is just la'ib. It's not serious. There's nothing serious about it. It's a place of amusement for the people. Wazinatun, beautification and adornment. That's what it is. Watafakhurun baynakum. It's boasting and bragging between one another. Watakathurun fil amwali wal awlad. It is increasing in wealth and children. You know how it is? Kamathali ghaythin a'jaba al-kuffara. The word ghayth here means rain. It's like the difference between ghayth and matar is that ghayth is not adab. Some of the rain that comes down is adab. Lakin ghayth is not adab. Araftum? So, when the rain comes down and it destroys a people like the people of Nuh, it's not referred to as ghayth. Ghayth is when the rain comes down and it brings vegetations. Okay? كَمَثَلِ غَيْثٍ أَعْجَبَ الْكُفَّارَ. And the word kufara here is referring to the farmers. The farmers are kufar. In the Arabic language, لِأَنَّ الْكُفْرَ فِي لُغَةِ الْعَرَبِ is what? السَّتُر وَالتَّغْطِيَة. The word الْكُفْرُ فِي لُغَةِ الْعَرَبِ is what? السَّتُر وَالتَّغْطِيَة is to conceal something, to bury something, conceal it. What did the farmers do? They take the seed and they put it in the earth, they cover it and they hide it. And that's why they are called kufar. So here it means, kufar here means the farmers. كَمَثَلِ غَيْثٍ أَعْجَبَ الْكُفَارَ نَبَاتُ ثُمَّ يَهِيجُ فَتَرَاهُ مُصْفَرًا ثُمَّ يَجْعَلُهُ حُطَامًا. Look at the cycle that happens to this earth. It's the same cycle that happens to the world and the people on this earth. They die, one generation goes, another people come. That's what the dunya. It's like, when Allah says, وَتَكَاثُرُ فِي الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَوْلَادِ, it's like the ayah Al-Hakami Al-Hakum al-Takathur, hatta zurtum al-Maqabir. Increase, increase, more money, more money, money. He goes and visits the grave. Have you ever seen someone who died and said, yeah, I was ready for death? You don't. Sahab al-Dunya, they always die, they want the dunya. Surah to Yunus is the ayah, innama mathalu al-hayati dunya. That's what it is. كما إن أنزلناه من السماء فاختلط به نبات الأرض مما تأكل الأنعام مما يأكل الأنعام مما يأكل الناس والأنعام. The Surah to Yunus's verse that he's referring to, that is Surah al-Kahf is not وضرب لهم مثلا حياة الدنيا كما إن أنزلناه من السماء فاختلط به نبات الأرض فأصبح هشيما تذروه الرياح وكان الله على كل شيء مقتدرا. And then المال والبنون, the next صفحة, المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا والباقية الصالحة عند ربك خير comes down. Okay, so those verses are all expanding on the same point. Allah keeps repeating in subhanahu wa ta'ala. Surah Al Imran and Surah Fatin and Ghafir, all of them, they have the same verses, which is وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاعُ الْغُرُورِ. All of them, they have it. Surah Fatir is more specific. Allah says, إِنَّ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنَّ وَعَدَ اللَّهِ حَقٌّ. صح؟ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنَّ وَعَدَ اللَّهِ حَقٌّ فَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكُمُ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا وَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكُمْ بِاللَّهِ الْغُرُورِ. صح؟ Surah Fatir. That's what Allah mentions, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Surah Ahqaf is, كَأَنَّهُمْ يَرَوْنَهُ. The ayah in Surah Al-Ahqaf. كَأَنَّهُمْ يَوْمَ يُوَعَدُونَ لَمْ يَلْبَثُوا إِلَّا سَاعَةً مِنَ النَّهَرِ. صح؟ That's the ayah in Surah Al-Ahqaf, right at the ending. And the hadith, وَكَمْ مِنْ حَدِيثٍ مُوجِبُ لِاعْتِزَالِهَا. How many hadiths command us to stay away from it? Surah Ahqaf is كَأَنَّهُمْ يَوْمَ يَرَوْنَ مَا يُعَدُونَ إِلَّا سَاعَةً مِنْ نَهَارٍ بَلَغْ فَهَلُوا لَكُوا إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. أي نعم. The next, the hadithna is the statement of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, where he says إِنَّ الدُّنْيَا مَلْعُونَةٌ مَلْعُونُ مَا فِيهَا إِلَّا ذِكْرُ اللَّهِ وَمَا وَالَهَا عَالِمٌ أَوْ مُتَعَلِّمٌ, أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. أما إِنَّ الدُّنْيَا حُلُوٌ خَضِرَةٌ وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ مُسْتَخْلِفَكُمْ فِيهِ فَيَنْظُرَ كَيْفَ تَعْمَلُونَ فَاتَّقُوا الدُّنْيَا وَاتَّقُوا النِّسَاءَ فَإِنَّ أَوَّلَ فِتْنَةِ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ كَانَتْ فِي النِّسَاءِ, أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. This dunya, its glimmers, the glitters and the beauty that you see, it's all a test from Allah. The hadith says فَاتَّقُوا الدُّنْيَا, stay away from the dunya, وَاتَّقُوا النِّسَاءَ, and stay away from the women. It's a fascinating how Allah connects the women with the dunya. It's amazing, right? When they're part of the dunya, but He makes it equal to the dunya. Yes. And Allah, the Prophet didn't do it once. He actually did it in a famous hadith in as-sahihain min hadith Umar, right? إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى فمن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله ومن كانت هجرته لدنيا يصيبها أو امرأة ينكحها. Another wording says أو امرأة يتزوجها. So the dunya and the woman mentioned together, because the fitna of the women and the dunya, it's the same weight. Why do the men run after the dunya? They say it's because of women. And why do the women want the man? It's because of the dunya. وَهَكَذَا, they say the cycle is connected like that. نعم.
لَقَدْ نَظَرُوا قَوْمٌ بِعَيْنٍ بَصِيرَةٍ إِلَيْهَا فَلَمْ تَغْرُرْهُمُ بِاخْتِيَالِهَا أولئك أهل الله حقا وحزبه لهم جنة الفردوس إرثا ويا لها.
The author رحمه الله, here what he's saying, it reminds me of a statement that Imam al-Shafi'i said. Nawawi mentions in the Muqaddim of Riyadh al-Salihin, right? Which the poet Imam al-Shafi'i, he said, Imam al-Shafi'i, he said, إن لله عبادا فطنا طلقوا الدنيا وخافوا الفتنا فلما علموا أنها ليست لحي وطنا اتخذوها لجة واتخذوا صالح الأعمال فيها سفنا. Something like that. Nawawi mentions in the Muqaddima of his kitab Riyadh al-Salihin that Allah has in this world عِبَادًا فُطَنَا smart creation. طَلَّقُ الدُّنْيَا they divorced the dunya. وَخَافُ الْفِتَنَا it's what Ilbiri mentions. تَفُتُّ فُؤَدَّكَ الْأَيَّامُ فَتَّى وَتَنْحِتُ جِسْمَكَ السَّاعَاتُ نَحْتَى وَتَدْعُوكَ الْمَنُونُ دُعَاءَ صِدْقٍ أَلَا يَا صَاحِ أَنْتَ أُرِيدُ أَنْتَ أَرَاكَ تُحِبُّ عِرْسًا ذَاتَ خِدْرٍ أَبَتَّ طَلَاقَهَا الْأَكْيَاسُ بَتَّى the smart people they divorced it three times يعني طلاق بينونة الكبرى لا رجعة فيه they divorced the dunya a divorce they will never take her back طلقوا الدنيا وخافوا الفتنة they were scared of the trials and tribulations of the dunya فَلَمَّا عَلِمُوا when they came to know about this dunya and how it's like they used it as a boat where they put all their stuff on and they sail away from it Shafi'i's statement here that's very powerful so this is the author's statement rahimahullah they looked at the dunya بِعَيْنِ بَصِيرَةٍ that's what they did and they worked towards what? They worked towards Jannah these are the righteous people they are Ahlullah أولئك أهل الله حقا وحزبه he says the sheikh and the أهل of Allah تبارك وتعالى based on the hadith الإمام ابن ماجة narrated in his sunan إن لله في الدنيا أهلا Allah has the people in this dunya وأهل الله في الدنيا and the people of Allah in this dunya is أهل القرآن the people of the Quran شاطبي mentions وإن كتاب الله أوثق شافع وأغنى غناء واهبا متفضلا وخير جليس لا يمل حديثه وترداده يزداد فيه تجملا وحيث الفتى يرتاع في ظلماته من القبر يلقاه سنا متهللا إذا أولئك أهل الله والصفوة الملا they are the people of Allah the أهل القرآن by the way في اصطلاح المتقدمين The early scholars, when they refer to as Qurra and the Ahlul Qur'an, they refer to it as يعني من حفظوا حروفه ولم يضيعوا حدوده. They memorized its wordings and they also upheld the boundaries that the Qur'an set. That's what they are. نعم.
ومال إليها آخرون لجهلهم فلما اطمأنوا أرشقتهم نبالها أولئك قوم آثروها فعوقبوا بها الخزي في الأخرى وذاقوا وبالها
ورى الله سنة سورة إسراء من كان يريد العاجلة عجلنا له فيها ما نشاء لمن نريد ثم جعلنا له جهنم يصلاها مذموما مدحورا ومن أراد الآخرة وسعى لها سعيها وهو مؤمن فأولئك كان سعيهم مشكورا كلا نمد هؤلاء وهؤلاء من عطاء ربك وما كان عطاء ربك محظورا انظر كيف فضلنا بعضهم على بعض وللآخرة أكبر درجات وأكبر تفضيلا يعني الله mentions سبحانه وتعالى that anyone who runs after the dunya من كان يريد العاجلة عجلنا له فيها ما نشاء in a hadith of Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم he said من جعل الدنيا أكبر همه Anyone who makes the dunya his ultimate goal and is running after the dunya, what happens? فَرَّقَ اللَّهُ الشَّمْلَهُ Allah will divide your strength and your power. وَجَعَلَ الْفَقْرَ بَيْنَ عَيْنَيْهِ Allah will place the poverty right in front of your eyes. وَلَمْ تَأْتِهِ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا And the dunya, you will not receive from it إِلَّا مَا كُتِبَ لَهُ Except that which was written for them. وَمَنْ جَعَلَ الْآخِرَةَ هَمَّهُ Anyone who makes the akhirah his desires, he runs after the akhirah. أَتَتْهُ الدُّنْيَا وَهِيَ رَغِبَةٌ The dunya is running after him. He said, get away from me. The dunya is running after him. He said, I don't want you. That's what the Shaykh Rahimahullah, that's what he means when he says, فَعُقِبُوا بِهَا الْخِزْيُ فِي الْأُخْرَى يعني ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَا لَهُ جَهَنَّمَ يَصْلَاهَا مَذْمُومًا مَدْحُورًا The dunya isn't يعني something to desire, wallahi brothers. It's not something. No one remained here forever. And no one will remain here forever. But we do, we make everything out of the dunya. The dunya, it means everything to us. And so you get tired running after it. And you leave it. And that's not what you regret. You regret the fact that you didn't do righteous actions. May Allah make us from those who benefit from this dunya. Who come with al-Iman wal-Amal al-Salih. نعم.
فقل للذين استعذبوها رويدكم سينقلب السم النقيع زلالها ليلهوا ويغتروا بها ما بدا لهم متى تبلغ الحلقوم تصرم حبالها.
الشيخ رحمه الله he's saying فقل للذين say to the people استعذبوها those who burnt themselves alive, يعني burnt themselves in this dunya by working too hard, those who يعني افتتنوا بزخرفها, they got deceived by its glitters and its glamours. رويدكم تمهلوا, take it easy, don't go, يعني that's what it means. سينقلب السم النقيع زلالها. What's going to happen is the harm is going to be very severe. You see it to be what? يعني زلال is the water that's so nice to drink. It's going to flip on you as a poison. That's what's going to happen to you. That's what this dunya is. It shows you something and the reality of it something else. ولذلك that's why the scholars they say ما ذكر الموت في مكان إلا ضيقه. When you ever think about death, at a time when you're in a good time and you're enjoying yourself and you've got money and everything and Allah, and you remember death, what does it do to you? It makes everything tight, right? مَا ذُكِرَ الْمَوْتُ فِي وَاسِعٍ إِلَّا ضَيَّقَهُ. Death has never been mentioned in a place where the person is wasi', just enjoying himself, except he makes everything tight, right? It makes some people would even say to you, Akhi, why are you mentioning it now? Imagine you went to a marriage ceremony and you spoke about death. At that moment where they're getting married and you talked about death, people are like, what are you doing? Because this moment, everyone's, it's happiness, right? وَمَا ذُكِرَ الْمَوْتُ فِي ضِيقٍ إِلَّا وَسَعَهُ. And death is never mentioned at a time when a person's going through hardship in life and suffering. They don't think about death except it brings them what? It makes things easy, you feel better. So death is as the Prophet said, because هذه من لذات, you can say هذه من لذات, you can say it's the destroyer of pleasure. That's why the Prophet said كنت نهيتكم عن زيارة القبور فزوروها فإنها تذكركم بالآخرة. I used to prohibit you from visiting the graves, and now I command you to go and visit the graves, for verily it will remind you of the hereafter. So a lot of these people, they don't think about death, and they don't go and see how it's like. Brothers and sisters, al-mubadaratu bit-tawbah, let's hasten to repentance and asking Allah for forgiveness, subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Don't give up. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept your repentance from you. نعم.
ويوم توفى كل نفس بكسبها تود فداء لو بنيها وما لها وتأخذ إما باليمين كتابها إذا أحسنت أو ضد ذا بشمالها ويبدو لديها ما أسرت وأعلنت وما قدمت من قولها وفعالها.
يعني ويوم توفى كل نفس بكسبها. The Sheikh is taking it from the ayah ثم توفى كل نفس ما كسبت وهم لا يظلمون فكيف إذا جمعناهم ليوم لا ريب فيه ووفيت كل نفس ما كسبت وهم لا يظلمون. Everybody, what would be taken for them? ما كسبت, that which it worked. What you did is what you're going to get. Nothing else. And the criminal, the criminal who did يعني معاصي, the thing that he will wish for that day, لو يفتدي من عذابي يومئذ ببنين. That's the thing. That's the wish he has. I wish I don't go to the hellfire. يعني that's what he's going to wish for. The believers who obeyed Allah, للذين استجابوا لربهم الحسنى, The ones who obey their Lord and Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, that's what they're going to have, good in Jannah. وَالَّذِينَ And the ones, لَمْ يَسْتَجِيبُوا لَهُ لَوْ أَنَّ لَهُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ لِيَفْتَدُوا بِهِ مِنْ عَذَابِ يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ مَا تُقُبِّلَ مِنْهُمْ The criminals and the ones who didn't obey Allah and His Messenger that day, they're going to wish they had a way out of it. They would try to give everything. ولذلك it will be said to them, لَوْ كَانَ لَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَمَا فِيهَا أَكُنْتَ مُفْتَدِي It will be said to them, if you had this dunya and everything in it, would you free yourself from what you're in? The person will say, of course I would. And then it will be said to them, إِنَّ اللَّهَ أَرَادَ مِنْكَ أَهْوَنَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ Allah just wanted something less than that from you. You don't have to say the dunya and everything in it. Less than that was needed from you and you didn't do it. أَوْ ضِدِّ ذَا بِشِمَالِهَا نَا Some people are going to take it with their right hand, some people are going to take it with their left hand. فَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوْتِيَ كِتَابُ بِيَمِينِ The one who takes the kitab with his right, فَيَقُولُ هَا أُمُقْرَأُ كِتَابِيَ He'll say to them, come on, everybody read with me. إِنِّي ظَنَنْتُ أَنِّي مُلَاقٍ حِسَابِي ظَنَنْتُ here means أَيْقَنْتُ The word ظَنِّي sometimes can come as يعني شك and sometimes it can come as يقين. So here, إِنِّي ظَنَنْتُ يعني أَيْقَنْتُ أَنِّي مُلَاقٍ حِسَابِيَ And he can't be shak here. If it is, then he didn't believe in the meeting of Allah. No, of course he did. يعني أيقنت أني ملاق حسابية فهو في عيشة راضية في جنة عالية قطوفها دانية This is the person who took it with his right hand. He's enjoying himself. As for the one who takes it with his left hand, who's been given his book in his left hand, he will say, يا ليتني لم أوت كتابية ولم أدري ما حسابية I wish I wasn't given my book. He's scared that day. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, everything is in there for him. Everything. And he's going to cry. He's going to weep. He's going to say, مَا لِهَذَا الْكِتَابِ لَا يُغَادِرُ صَغِيرَةً وَلَا كَبِيرَةً إِلَّا أَحْصَاهَا وَوَجَدُوا مَا عَمِلُوا حَاضِرًا وَلَا يَظْلِمُ رَبُّكَ أَحَدًا What's this book? It's got everything written in it. Everything I said, everything I did. I was only joking this day when I said this. بلكن ولقد خلقنا الإنسان ونعلم ما توسوس به نفسه ونحن أقرب إليه من حبل الوريد إذ يتلقى المتلقيان عن اليمين وعن الشمال قاعد ما يلفظ من قول إلا لديه رقيب عتيد. was written. So everything he's seen it, and he's going to cry that day. That book is not going to leave out anything. ليجزي الذين أساءوا بما عملوا ويجزي الذين أحسنوا الحسنى. Did you do good? You're going to get rewarded good. Did you do bad? You're going to get rewarded. This is the day where every single person is going to be judged. يَا الَّذِينَ عَمَلُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهُ وَالْتَنْظُرْ نَفْسُ مَا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدٍ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ Just think about that day, brothers and sisters, and ponder. Wallahi, we're going to a test. We've already been told the questions and some of us are going to fail. Imagine going to a test. You know all of the questions. And you've even been told the answers of those questions and how you should answer it. And some of us are going to go to the grave. We're going to be asked, مَنْ رَبُّكُ We won't be able to answer. مَنْ نَبِيُكُ مَا دِينُكُ We won't be able to. The day of judgment will come. We don't know it. So this is what the Shaykh رحمه الله says, وَيَبْدُوا لَدَيْهَا مَا أَسَّرَّتْ وَأَعْلَنَتْ وَمَا قَدَّمَتْ مِنْ قَوْلِهَا وَفِعَالِهَا Everything you put forward, that day it will be judged. You'll be judged for it. We're going to stop there, inshallah ta'ala. I'm just going to take your questions. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are both free from it. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdi, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh. Hey, anyone have any questions? Ustadh, why didn't Umar ibn Abdul Aziz get rid of the dynasty system of the Umayyads? Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, there were so many things he wanted to do. But the reason why he didn't do it is because Bani Umayyah were highly loved and appreciated in Sham. And no one else was, no one could try to take it over from them. ولذلك عبد الله بن الزبير رضي الله تعالى عنه, when he tried to take it, and he had it for a period of time, he took over a lot of parts of Sham. Bani Umayyah were not happy with that. And that's why Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, he sent Hajjaj ibn Yusuf to Medina, and that's when Abdullah ibn Zubayr was hanged on the Kaaba, right? So Bani Umayyah had a very strong grip in Sham. Okay? So even if Umar ibn Abdulaziz personally wanted to give it up or do, Bani Umayyah is stronger than him, the people he's from. So he saw it to be a mafsada to do certain things. Now, may Allah bless you and allow us to continue benefiting from you. Allahumma ameen. At the start, you mentioned the use of ikhtibas when the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Did the author do the same with the speech of Allah? Yeah, he did some verses here. He did some verses he took, and he did ikhtibas of it. Some of the scholars, they do that. They mention it, and it's a discussion of whether it's permissible or not. Whether you're allowed to do iqtibas of the Qur'an, there's discussion about it, regarding it. Barakallahu feek, Ustadh. Is it allowed for us to have baby showers, or is it imitating the non-Muslims? Remind me, baby showers, is it when the baby's born? The celebration they do? Yeah? After the baby's born? Before the baby's born. They celebrate it. For the baby's coming. I don't really know it properly. So I will just pause my thought on it. Ya Shaykh, Ahsanallahu ilaykum. I feel that I have so many sins to so many other people in my life. I don't know what to do. First of all, we're all sinners, wallahi, all of us. And we all do sins and we do mistakes, and you have to repent. Repentance is what we all keep have to doing. If it's Allah's rights, we have to keep repenting to Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet said, Ya ayyuhan nas, inni atubu fil yawm. Ya ayyuhan nas, tubu ila Allah, fa inni atubu fil yawm mi'ata marrah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that. O people, repent to Allah. I repent to Him every day. 100 times. Allah said in the Quran, Wa tubu ila Allah jami'an ayyuhal mu'minuna, la'allakum tuflihun. Wa staghfiru rabbakum. Ask forgiveness from your Lord. So forgiveness is something we all have to come with every day and ask Allah for forgiveness. And if it's the rights of people, then you have to ask those people for forgiveness. It's their rights. You have to, each and every one of them, ask them for forgiveness. Assalamu alaikum, Ustadh. I want to get a beginner tafsir book. Can you advise me with a good tafsir book? Two books I'll advise you with, Tafsiru Abdurrahman Nasir Sa'di and Tafsir al-Jalalain. Those two books are good. Ustadh, what is the ruling on saying may Allah guide so and so or break their backs? No, just make dua for people. Don't ask Allah to destroy people's backs. Say, oh Allah, guide the person. Ask Allah's guidance for the people. Ustadh, I ask Allah to guide us and keep us guided until we meet Him. How should my relationship be with my kids from Jahiliyyah, since they are not looked at as my kids in Al-Islam? What do you mean, your children from Jahiliyyah? Do you mean your children from Qabl al-Islam, before Islam? If it's before Islam, they're still your children. Qabl al-Jahiliyyah, I don't get. What do you mean Jahiliyyah? Do you mean Qabl al-Islam, you, before you took Islam, you had children? Then they're still your children. You still have to look after them. They have rights on you. Ustadh, can a woman wear a shoulder bag? Shoulder bag is a bag that she puts on her shoulders. Well, brothers and sisters, I don't understand these things properly, so I prefer not to say anything unless I know what it is exactly that it's meant by it. A woman, if it's a bag, a woman can have a bag. Shoulder bag, I don't know what it means particularly. What does it do? How is it like? Said, Barakallahu Fikum Ustad, since we are now in lockdown, when should we pray the Eid prayer? Is it better the sooner we do it? Pray the Eid prayer when your local masjid is praying your Eid prayer. You should follow the people that you're with, your local area. Whenever they're praying, try to pray with them, inshaAllah ta'ala. Ustadh, how do we know which publication of certain books are best? Should we ask a sheikh for every book we want to buy? Or are there overall guidelines we can use? No, you have to ask people who... Not every sheikh or not every student of knowledge knows it. So it's best to ask people who are into that, looking at manuscripts and different taba'at and the mistakes that are in it. So, now. Is sunnah.com a good website? I find it beneficial. I benefit from it. Sometimes hadith, I look at the English translation of it. Sunnah.com and Quran.com, and they're good websites that I benefit from personally. There are sometimes I see hadith that they translate it to be in a way that I think maybe it's not the right way to translate it. But I haven't seen something very dangerous or serious like that. See, may Allah reward the people who made it. It's a good benefit for the people. Ustadh, is As-Sunnah Islamic Center a good duksi? Are you referring to As-Sunnah Islamic Center in North London? Are you referring to the North London one? If you're referring to As-Sunnah Islamic Center in North London, they're very good, Allahumma barik. That's my masjid I used to go to when I was young. So yeah, I think you should go there, inshallah ta'ala. Ustadh, is it better to memorize the Quran first or get a tafsir? And ways I can memorize the Quran and not forget? Yeah, definitely memorize the Quran first. Start with the Quran and then try to work towards memorizing other things as you go along. But give importance to the Quran. Ustadh, please, the mosques are praying on different days in my city. Do we just pick anyone? Please advise. Generally, just follow the local masjid, your local masjid that's closest to you. In your area, in the UK, for example, just follow the one that's the closest to you and go there. And don't cause division by yani picking. If they pray, I said, just pray the time that they pray, inshallah ta'ala. I mean, I haven't seen masajids there that are way off in the time that they pray. So, Ustad, will we see you lead the prayer in Dar es Salaam South Hall? May Allah reward you one day, inshallah ta'ala. How to approach reading, studying Bulugh al-Maram as an individual without a teacher? I don't think you should study Kitab Bulugh al-Maram without a teacher. I think you should try to study with a teacher. Assalamu alaikum, Ustad. Do you know about the shuyukh in Zaytuna in Tunis we can take knowledge from? I don't know anyone now that are. I know the early scholars like Ibn Ashur and Muhammad Ibrahim al-Khadir, and I think it was him, and those great scholars who studied there. But I don't currently know no one now. I mean, back in the days, it was producing big scholars like Ibn Ashur and great scholars like that. But now I don't know. I don't know it now. Ustad, is it true that only 70,000 people will only be in Jannah? People are spreading this a lot. Only 70,000 people are going to be in Jannah? I've never heard it in my life. Unless they're confusing it with the hadith of the 70,000 who are going to go to Jannah بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ وَلَا عَذَابٍ. Hadith Sahih Muslim, Hadith Ibn Abbas. Yani, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he mentioned that there's going to be 70 who are going to enter Jannah without any hisab or adab. And then the Prophet mentioned هُمُ الَّذِينَ لَا يَسْتَرْقُونَ وَلَا يَكْتَوُونَ وَلَا يَتَطَيَّرُونَ وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. The Prophet mentioned their characteristics, alayhi salatu wasalam. They're not superstitious, they don't use quarters like fire, they don't burn themselves. They don't ask for ruqya. وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ, and they rely on their Lord. And there's another riwayah in Bayhaqi, which mentioned each 70,000, there's 70,000. So it's even more than that. But to say there's only 70,000 people going to Jannah, I haven't heard of such a thing. Assalamu alaikum, Ustad from Hyderabad, India, looking for online Quran classes for my nieces and nephews and kids. I think inshallah ta'ala is best to contact Kalemah and you could talk to them about the Quran classes, inshallah ta'ala. Okay, somebody asked a question. This is the last question I'm going to take. Ustad, if someone is smart and can learn the deen more as a talib of ilm, he works as an engineer, should he leave working and start just studying the religion deeper? Jazakallahu khairan. Yes, definitely, I think he should study the religion on a deeper level and give a lot of time to it, but he also should leave his job. He should work, the Muslim should work, Islam promotes somebody working. Should leave his job. But definitely, he should try to study the religion on a deeper level, inshallah ta'ala. I said that was going to be the last question I'm going to take, so that was the last Brothers and sisters, I love you guys for the sake of Allah. Anything I might have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are both free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdi ashhadu an la ilaha illallah astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.